Welcome, everyone. Good afternoon, and welcome to this joint hearing of the Senate Transportation and Housing Committee and the Senate Local Government Committee. First, I want to thank our Vice Chair of the Local Government Committee, my colleague, Senator Christine Kehoe, for joining me in co-chairing this hearing today, and I want to thank her staff and the staff of local government for also working with the staff of Transportation and Housing to put on this hearing together. We're holding this hearing in part because we're required to really, according to the California Election Code, to hold a hearing on the initiative, but we're also really doing this to illuminate and understand what are some of the what actually is in the initiative, what impacts it will have upon the state, general fund, and what possibly are some of the motivations behind Prop 22, and what will be some of the likely outcomes if Proposition 22 passes into the state constitution on November 2nd. Prop 22 proposes further changes to the complicated relationship between local governments and the state of California. This relationship has been indelibly shaped by Proposition 13 in 1978 and the ensuing 30 years of legislation of state and local budget making and ballot measures have lent, rather than a clarity, have made these interrelationship even more intertwined. I look forward to hearing today's witnesses. And before we go forward, I'd like to ask if members of the committee and first of the joint committee, Senator Kehoe, if you would like to make an introductory statement.
Thank you, Senator Lowenthal. Just briefly, I am happy to join Senator Lowenthal representing Senate Local Government Committee. I want to welcome everyone who's here, our witnesses, and other members of the public. The purpose of today's hearing is to go to the heart of the impacts of the passage of Proposition 22, if it does pass, on our California state budget and the impacts on the fiscal relationship between the locals and the state of California. And I think we should all be mindful that every dollar we discuss comes out of the same pocket, that is the people of California, in taxes and fees that they pay at the local level, the state level, and the federal level. So we want to have a clear discussion, knowing that there's no easy answers, but that simply saying it's my money or it's your money is not enough to make for a better process, that we need to find a way to deliver services to people and to find the revenues we need to do so effectively. So I would just like to say thanks again to the witnesses who are coming, both pro and con, and especially to the Legislative Analyst's Office for what I hope will be a cogent analysis of the issues that are facing us with this proposition. And whenever you're ready.
Well, are the Senator. Committee members wish to make an opening statement? Not hearing any. Look, shall we begin with our first witness?
We should indeed.
And I think our first will be Marianne O'Malley, and also I think Jessica DiGiambattista from the Ledger Analyst's Office. Today, you're going to provide us with all the insights and the education that we need so that we can ask cogent questions to both the proponents and opponents. Welcome.
Thank you. Marianne O'Malley from the Legislative Analyst Office. And as you mentioned, I'm also joined by our office's transportation expert, Jessica DiGiambattista. I'll be talking from this outline to this handout today of Prop 22. As you may know, our office, the Legislative Analyst Office, every statewide election since 1974 has been responsible for providing a fiscal analysis, an objective, nonpartisan, non-legalese fiscal analysis of the likely effect of all measures being placed before the statewide voters. And over the next 15, 20 minutes, Jessica DiGiambattista and I will be giving you such an overview of Prop 22. too. I should tell you at the outset, though, that I've worked in our office doing these analyses for a quarter century. And during my time at the LAO, I'd have to say that this measure has been singularly the most complicated that I've been responsible for doing work on. And part of the reason for it is, well, it's very long. It's 18 pages, single space. It amends the Constitution. It amends statute. It also works in many different areas: fuel taxes, the vehicle license fee, property tax, redevelopment agencies, transportation planning. And it was also drafted before the gas tax swap became current law. And so there are many times where we had to look at the measure and try to figure out how to harmonize it with existing law, and that was very difficult. We spent a great deal of time working with legislative counsel to try to figure out how this measure would affect current law, affect our current operations. And in not all answers times do we have clear answers. And I just caution you that at some time or another during our presentation, you're going to ask us, well, how does this measure affect blank? And we're not going to be able to give you a fully satisfying answer. We'll be happy to share with you our thinking, but in some cases, we just don't know the answer. So with that, let me just turn to the measure. In terms of the background, and those of you who have been following local government know some of this background by heart. In California, perhaps more than any other state in the United States, our state and local government affairs are highly interrelated. Our state and local governments actually share some of the same revenue sources on the fuel tax, on the sales tax. Many programs, particularly in health and social services programs, are administered or funded by both levels of government. Over the years, the state has made decisions that have affected local government. In the early 1990s, for example, the state used its authority over the property tax to give cities, counties, and special districts a smaller share of the property tax and schools a larger share of the property tax, and we did so to offset state general fund costs for education. Then later in the 1990s, around 1997, we shifted county costs for trial courts to the state. So the state has taken actions that have both helped and have also negatively affected the fiscal affairs of local government. Over the last few years, there's been a variety of local government of measures placed before the voters that have restricted state authority over local finance in one way or the other. The most notable of that is Proposition 1A of 2004. Proposition 22 follows in that tradition of limiting state authority over local finance. If you turn to the second page of the handout on Proposition 22 overview, this measure basically has five major things, and I'll be working on the first three, and I'll change the mic over to Ms. Giambattista to talk about the transportation ones. But it effectively reduces or eliminates state authority to redirect redevelopment property taxes, to shift property taxes, to use vehicle license fee revenue to reimburse for mandates, to use fuel tax revenues to pay for debt service, or to borrow or change the distribution of state fuel tax revenues. Now, we're going to be talking about the fiscal effect of all these provisions throughout this handout. Let me just give you at the outset, though, kind of the bird's eye view of the fiscal effect, which is, for the most part, there is no overall change to aggregate state-local revenues. This measure doesn't raise taxes. It doesn't lower taxes. It doesn't increase the cost of programs or decrease the cost of programs. Basically, what this measure does is it limits state authority to use certain revenues or to redirect certain revenues, and the fiscal effects result from that limitation on authority. The two biggest provisions from a fiscal effects standpoint are the limitations on state authority to require redevelopment agencies to shift revenues to schools, authority that the state has used nine times, I'm not exactly sure, but a significant number of times over the last 20 years. The other provision that has a very significant fiscal effect is the limitation on state authority to pay transportation bond debt from fuel tax revenue rather than from the general fund. These restrictions on state authority over the fuel and the property tax because the state authority is restricted, is going to require the state, the legislature, to take other actions as a result. And will be other actions in the range of about $1 billion to several $1 billion in some years. And the other actions that the legislature could take is reducing funding for other general fund programs, or increasing taxes or fees to raise revenues to support the programs. On the other hand, they would be comparable increases in redevelopment revenues and also transportation revenues, because those funds would not have been redirected. If you turn to the next page, authority over the property tax division. And this chart shows you the shares of the 1% of the property tax. And you can see a line kind of going down through the middle of it almost. On one side is counties, cities, and special districts. And the other side of the pie is redevelopment and school and community colleges. Now, under Proposition 13, the state has authority to allocate or to tell county auditors how to allocate the property tax. And this is the current allocation of it. Under Proposition 1A, however, the legislature's authority to allocate the property tax or to tell county auditors how to distribute the property taxes was limited. And you can see on the right side, counties, cities, and special districts. Under Proposition 1A, the legislature can't reduce those shares to give a bigger share to the school and community colleges, except under very limited circumstances. The legislature, twice in a decade, during a period of severe fiscal distress, can reduce the share going to counties, cities, and special districts by a total of 8% and use it for schools. Any funding amount, though, that is reduced from counties, cities, and special districts has to be repaid within 3 years with interest. So the legislature has temporary authority to shift from counties, cities, and special districts over to the schools, but it is very limited authority, and it's effectively functions as a short-term loan. Okay. The legislature still, however, by a two-thirds vote, can modify the shares of property taxes that are allocated on the right side, so counties, cities, and special districts. You could, by a two-thirds vote, still redirect a share of the property taxes that otherwise would go to a special district and give it to a city, or a city to a county. You still have that authority. But overall, shrinking of cities, counties, and special districts and providing increased revenues to school districts is something that can only be done twice in a decade under very limited circumstances. If you turn to the next page, there is a local ability, though, to affect the distribution of property tax, which is redevelopment. If a local agency, a city or a county, creates a redevelopment project, all growth in the property tax in that area goes to the city or the county redevelopment agency. It doesn't go and be distributed to schools and the other taxing jurisdictions. Redevelopment agencies are required to pass through a piece of their money, and that money is called a pass-through payment. If you turn to the next page, it gives you a summary of Prop 22's provisions regarding the property tax, redevelopment, and also the VLF, which is a small provision but of some interest. The first piece of this is that under Proposition 22, the state's authority to temporarily increase the school and community college's share of the property tax, that thing that the legislature's allowed to do twice in a decade under a period of severe fiscal distress, that would be eliminated. The state would still be responsible for repaying the existing Prop 1A loan, that $1.9 billion loan that we took out in 2009. So we'd still be responsible for repaying cities, counties, and special districts for that one-time shift, but we could not make another shift in the future.
Can I ask just one clarification on that point? It's my understanding that $1.9 billion loan from last year, though, because of the securitization mechanism that was also contained in 1A, there was no actual impact to cities and counties from that loan. We're repaying a securitized loan over the 3 years, but it's not that they didn't get the money or that we're giving it directly to them.
That is correct. The state set up a securitization mechanism that fully offset all local government property tax losses. They did not receive a delay, and they did not receive any fiscal losses associated with it. The next provision relates to redevelopment property tax revenues. The measure appears to eliminate state authority to enact new laws that would shift. I'm sorry, we're on page 5. It's called Prop 22 Provisions, Property Tax Redevelopment, VLF, and we're on the second bullet. The measure would prohibit the state from borrowing or redirecting redevelopment property tax revenues or requiring increased pass-through payments. So the legislature couldn't direct redevelopment agencies to share a piece of their property tax with schools in the future, or to give an increased pass-through payment, say, to counties or some other entity. And then the third provision here relates to the vehicle license fee. This is something the legislature has not done in the past, but has considered doing so. There is some vehicle license fee revenues that is allocated to cities and counties, and actually some that DMV maintains for their own purposes. And there have been various proposals over the years to shift some vehicle license fee revenues, usually in the range of $100, $200, $300 million annually, to a local government and to have them offset certain mandated obligations. This is something the legislature has not done in the past, but under Prop 22, a legislative reallocation of the vehicle license fee could not be used to offset mandate cost. The next page, page 6, goes over the fiscal effect of those three provisions. And again, there is no change to overall state local government cost or revenues. We're not increasing taxes, we're not decreasing taxes, we're not increasing costs, we're simply limiting state authority over certain revenues. There would be redevelopment agencies would probably have higher revenues than otherwise would be the case because the legislature couldn't enact a measure that required a shift of the property taxes. But alternatively, the legislature would have to take in some other action in order to increase, in order to be able to address its fiscal or policy concerns. In terms of the other provisions, the local governments, there is some potential for a small increase in property tax stability over the very long term because we could not do a Proposition 1A loan. On the other hand, the legislature would have to figure out another mechanism for addressing severe fiscal stress. And there's also some potential higher state cost to implement a program realignment because that one option, the vehicle license fee reallocation, would no longer be available to the legislature. And with that, I'd be changing the microphone over to my colleague.
Thank you. On page 7 of the handout, we have the first of several major provisions related to transportation from Proposition 22. This first provision has also ties into the fiscal effect of the measure, and basically Proposition 22 restricts the use of fuel tax revenues to pay for bond costs, debt service costs on transportation bonds. Under current law, the Constitution allows the state to use up to 25% of gasoline and diesel excise tax revenues as well as truck weight fees to pay debt service costs on eligible transportation bonds. In addition, some funds in the public transportation account are eligible to pay debt service on transit bonds. And in 2010-11, as part of the conference committee version, as part of the fuel tax swap, it's already adopted. In 2010-11, the state will pay about $850 million in transportation debt service costs from these fuel tax funds, as opposed to paying them from the general fund, absent the changes that were adopted under the fuel tax swap. These would have been paid from the general fund, and so this provides some general fund relief. On an ongoing basis, the debt service costs that would be paid from transportation funds under the tax swap are estimated to top about $1 billion annually for the next several decades. Proposition 22 would restrict the state's authority to use these funds to pay debt service costs. Specifically, the measure would prohibit the state from paying any debt service costs on bonds that have already been sold, and it significantly restricts the state's ability to pay debt service costs on bonds that have yet to be sold. Yes.
I have a question. It restricts the ability of the state, you're saying, to use the fuel tax, the gasoline tax, to pay for existing debt service, mm-hmm. and limits the ability to do the state to use in the future for new bonds unless it has a vote of the people or goes to the... Is that not so? How it limits it?
Yeah, for bonds that were sold prior to the November 2nd election date, the state would be completely prohibited from paying debt service on those with any of the fuel tax revenues. For bonds sold after that date, it's not entirely clear, but it appears that there would possibly need to be a second vote of the people in order to approve the use of fuel tax revenues to pay debt service costs.
So those are on state bonds. Does it have the same limitations to local governments?
No. The measure does make changes to local governments' ability to use...
So they have complete flexibility, but the state, they can use fuel tax to pay their share if they pass the bond for local bonds.
Correct, yeah.
Just the state can't.
Yeah, it somewhat eases up. There's certain statutory provisions that are already ongoing, and it basically puts those into the Constitution so that the local agencies would not need to come and have legislative approval in order to use their share of gas tax funds.
And would they have to go to the public, too?
The bonds that they pay would have to be voter approval, but they would not need an extra approval of their voters in order to use the funds.
So it's just the state that would do.
Correct. It's putting these restrictions on the state and not on the local agencies.
I'm sorry, Mr. Chairman. Has anybody looked at how this could be legal retroactively? I mean, have we had Ledge Council or something? I mean, this whole notion that we're going to retroactively unpay bonds that we already issued and already agreed to pay?
Well, so I think we did work with Legislative Council extensively throughout this process, and there are some provisions in Proposition 22 that seem to imply some retroactivity of the measure. In terms of the bond costs, it takes effect as of the date that it would pass. So in terms of what you plan for 9/10 and the fiscal effect in 9/10, the debt service costs that would be paid, they're paid out on the first of each month, so the debt service costs that would be paid through November 1st would probably be okay. It's possible they could be challenged in a future court action, but you wouldn't have to go back and unpay those with fuel tax funds and then pay them with the debt. But going forward, all of those costs would have to be paid from some other source, most likely the general fund.
But could we stop issuing bonds at that point? Well, but if we'd already issued them, we still owe the debt, mm-hmm. right?
Exactly.
But we could stop issuing future bonds, particularly for local projects if we needed to, right?
Yeah. If you turn to page 8 of the handout, the next major transportation provision is that Proposition 22 prohibits the borrowing of fuel tax revenues. So under current law, state fuel tax revenues must be used for transportation purposes, but there's provisions in the Constitution that allow these funds to be used either on a short-term basis or a temporary basis for other purposes. Specifically, they can be loaned within a fiscal year for cash flow purposes, and the transportation accounts are borrowable funds. They're used for the state's overall cash flow. Loans from these accounts amount to about $1 billion annually. In addition, in terms of cash flow, Caltrans within the family of transportation funds will shift money around between its different accounts in order to have enough money to pay out contractors on various projects without having to maintain a large balance in each account. And so that allows them to allocate more projects on a cash basis. There's also borrowing that's allowed currently in the Constitution on a budgetary basis in times of severe state fiscal hardship. The state can borrow funds for up to 3 years and then repay them. And this is something that has been used in the past in 8, 9, 9, 10, and as part of the conference committee budget. There have been loans from state highway account revenues, which would include these revenues. For 10-11, the loan that's assumed in the conference committee budget is a $650 million loan. Proposition 22 would completely prohibit all borrowing of these revenues for either for the sort of day-to-day cash flow purposes and for budgetary purposes.
Would that also be retroactive or not? I mean, in other words, would the loan that's in the current year budget be theoretically undone, or if we passed a budget that included it, would that already be?
It's not entirely clear, but I think it's probably safe to err on the side of past loans that have already been done but not repaid would probably not be impacted, and our discussions with everybody, that seemed to be the consensus. It's not outside the realm of possibility. If it went to court, somebody could conclude something different, but that's pretty safe bet to assume. In terms of what would happen for the 10-11 year, because that $650 million loan wouldn't be taken as a lump sum on the first day that a budget is passed, it'd actually be taken in monthly increments as the fuel tax revenues flow into the state. And so the assumption that we made in our analysis is that any loans, you know, the monthly increment of loans that hadn't been transferred from transportation funds into the general fund would stop after the election if Proposition 22 were to pass. And so that accounts for about $380 to $400 million of the fiscal effect in 9-10 in terms of the hit to the general fund from this initiative. And then on page 9, we have the last major provision related to transportation. Proposition 22 in several different areas limits the state's authority to change the distribution or allocation of revenues between the state and between local governments. Proposition 22 locks in the excise tax distribution formulas that were in place on June 30th of 2009. That was before the fuel tax swap was enacted. And so at that time, cities and counties received 6 cents of the state's 18 cents excise tax. And so it would lock in that 6 cents to cities and counties. Currently, the legislature could change that distribution with a majority vote. Under Proposition 22, in order to change that distribution, the California Transportation Commission would have to conduct a series of public hearings and prepare a report. The legislature could then change it, but with a two-thirds vote as opposed to a majority vote. With respect to transit funds, Proposition 22 also limits the state's authority to change the allocation of diesel sales tax revenues, which is the one source of revenues that now flows into the public transportation account under the tax swap. Currently, diesel sales tax revenues are split with 75% going to local transit agencies and 25% available for state purposes. Prop 22 would change that distribution to a 50-50 split, and it would lock that into the Constitution. And so local agencies from those diesel sales tax revenues would actually get a lower share of transit funds than they do currently under the tax swap legislation. By setting these formulas in the Constitution, it essentially prohibits the legislature from ever changing the formula in the future. The only way to change the distribution would be to go back to the people in a subsequent measure.
Jessica, can you go through that one more time? Local transit agencies will get less under Prop 22 than they would with the gas swap and the increase in the sales tax on diesel?
That's correct. Historically, funds in the public transportation account were split 50-50, half to the state, half to local transit agencies. Then in recent years, because of the state's budget problems and because of very high revenues to the public transportation account from high gasoline prices when the state was charging a sales tax on gasoline and was receiving the spillover revenues, as some of those funds were being used to help out the general fund, and consequently, the legislature and governor enacted changes to the shares that would go to the state versus the local agencies, and they changed probably every year for several years. The last time they were changed was with the gas tax swap, which provided 75% of the funds to local agencies because the amount of money going to the PTA was smaller from the gas tax swap than it had been previously. And 25% of that goes to the state. Because Proposition 22 was written prior to the tax swap, it attempted to revert to the historical 50-50 split. But now, because there's only the diesel sales tax revenues going into that account, it would actually result in less money from that source going to transit operators than would be the case under current law.
Does this Prop 22 actually repeal the swap so that we have to reimpose the sales tax on gasoline?
That's a very good question. This will be one of those questions where we don't have a very satisfying answer for you. It's not entirely clear. The provisions that we have listed in the handout here are those things that after reading through the 18 pages single space, we've distilled down that we know are going to happen, and they're going to happen pretty much right away, or they're going to take effect sort of on their own without having to go through any sort of process of interpretation or to the courts. It's possible, that is one option in the realm of possibility, that the entire gas tax swap, I would say that's on one very extreme end of the realm of possibility, that in order for that to happen, it would take an action by the court. Somebody would have to sue the state to say, under certain provisions of Prop 22, to say that either the gas tax swap was a measure in conflict with Prop 22, or there's a couple of other provisions that wouldn't so cleanly undo the swap, but could maybe undo pieces of it. And so it would depend on if anybody were to sue under Proposition 22 challenging the gas tax swap and what they sued on, and then the interpretation by the court. And probably the most likely thing is the court would try to harmonize what Prop 22 does and what the legislature was doing, and you'd get somewhere in the middle.
Yeah, that's unclear then, those issues. What is clear, though, you're saying, is that that debt service would be moved back to the general fund from the excise tax. So whether it's declared unconstitutional or not, but we still have to now pay existing debt service from previous debt, like 1B, out of the general fund.
Correct.
But in theory, we could reimpose the sales tax on gasoline, restrict the excise tax to the 6 cents that the locals get, and use the sales tax on gasoline to pay the debt instead of transit.
That's general fund anyway, so.
Yeah.
Well, the sales tax, the debt service is not an eligible use of most of the sales tax on gasoline. When there is a sales tax on gasoline, the Proposition 42 split would still apply. So 40% would go to cities and counties, 40% to the STIP, and 20% to the public transportation account. Okay. That 20% that does go to the PTA was previously eligible to be used to pay debt service costs on transit bonds. However, if Prop 22 were to pass, because it does restrict the uses of PTA funds, that would no longer be an option. So going back to the sales tax wouldn't really work to get.
So it doesn't really repeal the swap. In other words, we continue to get excise tax.
Correct.
And have no sales tax under, but no benefit from it.
Correct. Yeah, there's nothing in Proposition 22 that relates to tax rates or undoing the tax swap. It was written before the tax swap was ever passed.
But when we did the swap, how much more than 6 cents were the locals getting from the excise tax? Or were they still only getting 6 cents under the current?
They still get 6 cents of the 18 cents, and then they get a percentage share of the increased amount of what's left over after debt service.
But that's
paid.
Only under the statute, the gas tax swap.
Correct.
Statute.
Yes.
If this passes, that money could be redirected to the STIP.
Correct, yeah. For the new excise tax that was passed under the swap would not, the allocation of those funds would not be locked in based on the limitation on state authority to change distributions, because that formula was not in place on June 30th, 2009, which is what's referenced in Prop 22. You'll have a lot of complicated options to try and change things if this does pass, in order to try and meet the state's needs and tailor funding to priorities. However, it is going to restrict you further than what you currently are. And as you're aware, transportation funding, because it does come in all these different little pots, it already is kind of segmented and restricted anyways. And so this will just sort of further tighten that up so that you have less flexibility to make changes to meet what your transportation priorities are. And then page 10 of the measure, it just ties together the fiscal effect. It really relates back to the debt service and the loan provisions. In 10-11, the effect to the state general fund would be about $1 billion. Most of this is coming from the inability to continue paying debt service. We sort of prorated it based on the last 7 months of the year as the debt service payments go out on a monthly basis. And so that's how it's sort of less than the total amount if you add up from the previous pages. And then the remainder of that is the sort of prorated amount of that $650 million loan that would no longer be allowed to be transferred. There's a longer-term effect.
Let me just ask you, how much do you attribute to debt service being shifted to the general fund of the $1 billion?
Probably about over $500 million of it. Yeah.
So and then the rest is the short-term borrowing, so it's about 50-50?
Well, no, but there's the $650 million loan.
For 10-11, maybe about two-thirds of it is attributable to the debt service.
Okay.
And there's around $380 million that is attributable not to the short-term borrowing, but the budgetary borrowing, which is that $650 million loan that's assumed in the conference committee budget. In the fiscal effect here, we're talking about budget impact and not the cash impact. So in addition, there would be other things that would affect the cash situation. But in terms of, I don't know what the
In terms of the short-term cash flow borrowing, put aside the budgetary borrowing, just on a normal state budget year, most of the state spending happens in the fall and early winter. Most of the state revenues come in the spring and in the very early summer. And so even in a good fiscal year, the state oftentimes has to borrow because it has expenditures during the first part of the fiscal year and revenues in the second part of the fiscal year. And even in a good year, we borrow internally, and one of the sources that we borrow from are the various fuel tax revenues, and we go borrow externally on the marketplace to be able to help manage our cash flow needs. Now, as a result of if this measure were to be passed, we would have less ability to borrow internally from our special funds, and as a result, we'd have to borrow more externally. We did do some looking at kind of on an average monthly basis, how much are we borrowing internally from these affected fuel tax revenues, and it's about $1 billion. And then we figured out kind of on a monthly basis or on an annual basis, how much would that increase our short-term borrowing cost? And it's probably something in the range of tens of millions of dollars. It is significant, but it is in the realm of the fiscal effects of this measure of lesser importance than many of the other factors.
And the last two components of the fiscal effect is the longer-term effect to the state general fund. Under the tax swap legislation, the state enacted a policy of paying three-quarters of Proposition 1B debt service and all of the Proposition 192 debt service from gasoline and diesel excise taxes that would not be allowed under Proposition 22. And so these costs, which are projected to reach over $1 billion annually, would have to be paid from the general fund. The flip side of the effect is that the funds that are not now paying debt service because the general fund is paying them would be available for other transportation purposes. So the total amount of money isn't going to change, but the way that it's being split up and used is going to change. And from a general fund standpoint, it's going to create, you know, budget problem for you. But those funds would be available for transportation projects.
So you don't, the billion-dollar gap that this creates, you see that being maintained over the next several decades? You say the next couple of decades? It doesn't grow, it doesn't get greater?
No, so in 10-11, the $1 billion is made up of several different components, mostly debt service. Then there's also this $650 million budgetary loan. There's also some smaller amount of costs on the cash, preventing cash flow borrowing. And so that totals up to about $1 billion. In terms of the longer term, what we assume is just the debt service. We don't assume any sort of ongoing loans because there's no you know, policy enacted to continue borrowing, even though that is an option to the legislature. And so
next year we have, what, a $10 billion deficit projected right about now? I mean, these numbers change a lot. So this would increase that by 10% if it passes for 2010-11.
Yeah. You'd have roughly a billion. For 11-12, it might be slightly less than a billion. In the out years, it would be higher than a billion. You know, on average, our number is about a billion over the next several decades.
But that's assuming we continue to issue transportation bonds?
It is assuming we continue to issue transportation bonds. However, for 11-12, most of your costs are going to be on bonds that were already issued, just in terms of, you know, how many are outstanding and then the timing of when new ones would be issued and when the payments would be due. So.
Sure. What your overview now? Is this good policy? I mean, here we're putting the impact. We're undoing the sales tax swap. You know, we're adding $1 billion to the general fund. I mean, for us sitting up here, we're just seeing. This is an example of people wanting to get what they can, and the hell with everyone else. And so,
I'm not sure.
You know, but that's from our perspective. We see this we worked so hard on the sales tax swap. Now, apparently, we're not going to be able to get the relief to the general fund. It just looks to this person that poorly thought out. I'm just wondering.
You'll have another two panels that will be very helpful in giving you opinions on this. Our office's responsibility is nonpartisan, objective, non-legalese analysis. And we try to carefully...
This is not a partisan response that I'm saying. No, I would hope.
Well, one thing I would ask then is if it does pass and you're before us next January or February, what strategies would you be recommending that the budget committee or other committees in the Senate take up to cope with the impacts of Proposition 22? What would we do?
I think we'd have to wait and see how it works.
And what would you recommend?
I don't know. I think we would need for court interpretation. Do you know what it fully does?
We would have to get back with you when we return, and hopefully with another whole cadre of some lawyers alongside us as to what would be the state's options. Again, this measure doesn't decrease revenues or increase revenues, but it does make your job harder in terms of paying for the transportation bonds, in terms of meeting all your other obligations. And I'm certain if this measure were to pass, we'd be here working with you to try to figure out the best way to implement your budget objectives.
You've mentioned just one quick thing, that you've mentioned courts and lawyers and lawsuits a number of times, both of you, in your presentations. I can only assume that you think that this is something that will be, if passed by the voters, will wind up in court in in a number of different areas, the retroactivity that Senator Cheney mentioned and other things.
Frankly, although this measure is particularly complex, especially because it was drafted before the gas tax swap, virtually all ballot measures, one day or the other, end up in court and require some kind of legal interpretation and guidance. This measure is not so unique from all the other measures that the voters have considered. They all require some kind of future legal analysis and court opinions.
Yeah, let's go now. Thank you both for the background. It really helped us. Let's go to the proponents. Chris McKenzie, Executive Director of the League of California Cities, and Josh Shaw, Executive Director of the California Transit Association.
Good afternoon. I'm Chris McKenzie with the League of California Cities, here on behalf of the League and our over 470 members. I want to thank you for the opportunity to address you, thank the chairs, members of the committee. We qualified Proposition 22 for the ballot with probably the greatest number of volunteer signatures that any ballot measure on the November ballot has. Over 84,000 signatures were collected on a voluntary basis, by most of them by city elected officials who are in exactly the same position you're in. Every year they put together a budget, and this year I believe all of them did it by July 1st or shortly thereafter, and now they're waiting. They waited last year, and they're waiting even longer this year for the other shoe to drop. And that other shoe, as it did last year, could contain reductions in the revenues they assumed in putting their budget together, revenues that the law provides should be used at the local level. If you are struggling to understand why this measure is on the ballot, it is the frustration, the years of frustration, as your staff, I think, has very ably pointed out, of putting budgets together only to see the revenues disappear out the back door. Now, I totally agree with Senator Kehoe, and I think our members do as well, that these revenues belong to the taxpayers of California. But we should not forget, they have spoken very clearly about how they want these revenues to be used.
Do you include in that Prop 1A? When voters voted on Prop 1A that the League agreed to?
Yes, Senator, and I'd be happy to respond to your implied question if you'd like me to. The voters voted on Prop 1A, and as part of that arrangement with the legislature, language was not included to specifically protect redevelopment because there is a parallel redevelopment provision in Article 16. And despite assurances that we received that it was not necessary, we've now seen $2.1 billion of redevelopment funds taken. And last year, there was a near raid of the highway users tax revenues, not alone, but a near $1 billion raid of those funds. So the vulnerability of these revenues has become all too clear to us. The property tax loan provisions that you've discussed, yes, they're part of Proposition 1A. But just at the time that local governments are faced with the same fiscal crisis the state is, we saw a loan take place of those monies. Yes, it was securitized, but there is no constitutional obligation to securitize those revenues. And in 3 years, the state is obligated to pay back those revenues plus the equivalent of about 15% interest due to the securitization cost. Now, fortunately for us, you securitized. But that cost is going to be borne by the taxpayers of our state for 3 years from now, has to be paid off when those bonds are paid off. So what Prop 22 is designed to do is to really reinstate in a significant way, and we believe this is a serious reform measure. I respect that you may disagree with that from where you sit, but we believe it's a serious reform measure to reinstate to the maximum extent we could the separation of sources doctrine that we had before Prop 13. At that time, it was clear to the voters which taxes they paid to their local government and which taxes they paid to their state government. But it has become incredibly cloudy, as you know. We have built this Rube Goldberg machine, or allowed it to be built, and it's very hard for state or local elected officials to be accountable for the allocation of the revenues and where they go. What is very clear in this environment is that we need to wait till you adopt your budget before we can really finalize ours. And on top of that condition, just like you, we have had cities all across our state reopen their budgets in the last year to try and adjust, not for just what the state did, but for the economic downturn. So it's been a dreadful year for everybody concerned. But here is the bottom line. You don't have a rainy day fund, or whatever you want to call it. Cities can get criticized for having reserves, but the reality is a reserve is necessary. It is a fiscally prudent measure. Some of us believe you don't have a rainy day fund because you can use local funds as your rainy day fund. That, we would submit to you, is fundamentally wrong.
The voters passed our rainy day fund. We have a rainy day fund. It was a proposition passed in 2004.
And Senator,
I am. We fill it up, we use it.
You use it, and when you need more, you take it from local government. And that is the perception of the local officials of our state, I believe.
That may be true as a perception, and it doesn't necessarily mean the reality. Can you get to the gas tax swap of $1 billion?
Be happy to. Be happy
to. And the loss to transit? I'm dying to hear why you want to lose money on this deal.
Be happy to get to the, and I'll turn it over to Josh to talk about the transit issue. As your LAO staff appropriately observed, this was drafted before the gas tax swap, but it contemplated the gas tax swap in this respect. In part because you'll recall there was a budget proposal that was adopted by majority vote that was going to substitute a fee, a gas fee, I know many of you were involved in this, in place of the excise tax and the sales tax. This measure contains an explicit provision, like, by the way, Prop 42 does. Go back and read Prop 42, that deals with successor revenues. And it says that if the sales tax on gasoline is reduced or eliminated and another tax for the same purpose is increased, that the same protections and allocations travel with that money and are applied. Again, I would stress, current law says that too. If no one has told you that, I would urge you to have your staff look into it. The sales tax on gasoline has now been eliminated. The excise tax, an equivalent amount, which as you well know is adjusted, is in its place. That revenue under Prop 22 and under Prop 42 legally functions as if it were sales tax on gasoline. So we don't think the swap has disappeared. We believe, and our attorneys do not, we've looked at this very, very carefully.
And the ability to pay, you're saying to us, your attorneys will say that we have the ability to pay out of the excise tax on gasoline debt service on existing
We believe you have much more flexibility to pay debt service than you've been told.
It depends on if tranches have been issued before or after November 2nd.
Do you want to answer that? No.
Yeah. Mr. Chairman, would you like me to address that? Joshua Shaw, Executive Director of the California Transit Association. On that point, our attorneys would tell you, as LAO alluded to, it's not crystal clear, but we believe...
It's real clear, Jen, that the excise tax cannot pay for the existing debt service.
Listen very carefully to what she said. There are bonds approved by the voters before November 2nd of 2010. Obviously, all the bonds that we're talking about right now. There are many, many, many billions of tranches worth of those bonds not yet issued to Wall Street. There's a reading of Prop 22 that suggests you can go ahead and issue those tranches on bonds already approved by the voters after November 2nd of 2010 and pay debt service out of the excise taxes.
Can I Yeah, under Proposition 22, it's not entirely clear, but the language of their measure refers to a voter approval twice. Once it refers to a voter approval with respect to the bond, meaning that the bond authorization itself, such as Prop 1B, would have had to have been approved by the voters. It also has a second voter approval, which appears to be in reference to the use of fuel tax revenues to pay for the debt service costs. For Proposition 1B and Proposition 192, there is no voter approval saying, yes, you can pay off these bonds with excise tax revenues. So under that interpretation, you would not be able to pay any of the bonds that have not yet been issued. It's not entirely clear the way it's... Yes. You definitely can't pay it for the bonds that have already been issued, and you most likely cannot pay it for the bonds that have yet to be issued. For the bonds that have not yet been issued, you would most likely need... Correct.
Senator, I think we just have to go on record. We disagree with that interpretation.
You're saying if we paid bond debt after this passed, you wouldn't sue?
I'm perfectly willing to sit here, Senator Duchenne, and say that my board of directors has no plans to sue under any aspect of this measure right now if the goals of the gas tax swap passed by the legislature and signed into law by the governor on March 22nd of this year remain in effect through subsequent legislative action. Where the bond debt piece, I just explained, our view is you can continue to pay for the bond debt service on tranches of bonds not yet sold to Wall Street if those are sold after November 2nd of 2010. And that was with regard to gas tax. With regard to the public transportation account, you did not just interact with the LAO on that question and her point earlier. There's nothing in Prop 22 that says you cannot pay bond debt service on transit bonds out of the public transportation account. There are some provisions that say you can't put money into the general fund, but that doesn't mean you can't pay the bond debt service directly out of the public transportation account. So as long as the rest
of the... But
there'll
be no money left in the public transportation account under your Prop 22, right?
Where would the
money to the PTA come from?
As the LAO explained, as I think you know, the remaining source of revenue to the public transportation account is the sales tax on diesel fuel, which was beefed up because you simultaneously eliminated more than $1 billion of potential funding for the public transportation account when you passed the gas tax swap. So what's left is a roughly $400 to $430 million source to the public transportation account, which would, under the measure, be spent on its historic purposes. The measure respects exactly the historic average formula enacted in statute over 30 to 40 years and allows the continued expenditure of those funds thusly. Yes, there's less than $1 billion available because you passed a bill that destroyed permanently the sales tax on gasoline, of which the spillover and the small increment of sales tax on the Prop 111 gas tax increase historically went to the public transportation account, in addition to Prop 42, which no longer exists now. What's left, therefore, is that fourth piece, the sales tax on diesel fuel.
Can I ask a question talking about the Prop 42 distribution staying in place, given even with the gas tax swap, if that's in place? Are you saying that transit can receive funds out of the excise tax? Is that the implication?
Chairman Lowenthal, if you don't mind, I'd like to back up and state as categorically as I can that Section 12 of Prop 22, the so-called conflicting statutes section, does not repeal the gas tax swap.
That's why we're asking you.
The gas tax swap is about eliminating the sales tax on gas because, according to Shaw v. Chung, a lawsuit that went to the California State Supreme Court last year, and they sided with me on the Shaw in that measure, in that litigation. I'm the Shaw in the initiative. I'm the Shaw in the lawsuit. The Supreme Court said you can't steal illegally the spillover anymore, which is what had been done for at least the last decade. I think the sergeant handed you a piece of paper that says more than $5 billion has been stolen from the public transportation account since 2001. So the Supreme Court last year said you can't do that. So what does the governor say? He says, well, if I can't steal that money for transit, never borrowed it, by the way, never borrowed it, unlike the discussion on gas tax where you can talk about whether it's right to borrow it, what the Constitution did say under Prop 1A or doesn't say. The Constitution said you could borrow PTA money. You almost never did. You stole it illegally. The Supreme Court said you can't do that anymore. Well, if you can't do that and you still have a general fund problem that you're either unwilling or unable to resolve in terms of raising new revenues or cutting expenses, and you can't steal from Peter to pay Paul because of the Supreme Court decision, what you do is
you steal from the schools to pay Paul.
I don't want to steal a thing from the schools. That assumes it's appropriate to put transit money into the state general fund and spend it on schools. I have a young son. I just had him this year. Thank God. I look forward to him going to school every day in essentially a cathedral of public school learning supported by a robust California State General Fund, which historically has had nothing to do with transit funding. Transit funding
comes off everything to do with property tax.
Wasn't a voter in 1978.
Would you?
Totally willing to get in a time machine and go back and change that. Appreciate the restrictions under which you're working. But in the meantime, under Senator Lowenthal's unfortunate comment about it seems like the proponents want to get theirs, and I think you said, Senator Lowenthal, the hell with everyone else.
That's exactly what I said.
I would point out that a series of votes by this legislature have said to hell with the people who ride transit every single day. Where do you think those people are going? A bunch of them are going to school. A bunch of them are going to health care. A bunch of them are going to hospitals.
I think it was this legislature, this past legislature, that put in the sales tax on diesel for transit.
Yes.
It was not required.
Yes. Thank you very much. When you said, and to Senator Duchenne's question, why are you dying to lose transit money? I think you were saying that to me, Senator Duchenne. Yeah, it's true that on January 8th of this year, the governor, in light of the Xiaovi Cheng lawsuit, said, well, let's just get rid of that source entirely. Let's just not have transit funding anymore. Let's convert the value of that more than $1 billion a year of transit funding into streets, roads, highways, and general fund bond debt service. The legislature, thank you for those of you who supported that effort, said, no, let's keep some transit funding. Let's keep some. So what you did was agreed with the governor to get rid of $1 billion a year in transit funding. What's left is the sales tax on diesel fuel. When we wrote the measure before the gas tax swap, we assumed it would be respectful to keep in place the formulas that have historically been here. And the measure, by the way, doesn't say there has to be taxes in California. We respect your plenary power to raise or lower taxes. You exercised that power quite effectively in March of this year when you eliminated $1 billion of potential transit funding. But when we wrote the measure, we assumed that it would be good to respect the historic 30 to 40 year formula, which splits PTA money half to the state for things like union jobs at Caltrans, for things like intercity rail, which we all support, as well as local transit. And then in March of this year, you said to us, essentially, with a gun to our head, $1 billion is going to go away. You can't stop that, transit people who ride transit, you can't stop that. We're going to leave you $400 million. How do you want that money? And we said, if we have to pick, if you're forcing us to pick, if you're going to side with the governor and eliminate $1 billion of transit funding a year.
That assumes spillover is always $1 billion, which it hasn't always been.
That's true.
That assumes $4 an hour, dollar an hour
ever.
Gasoline.
We haven't
never
received
got $1 billion
it because you've taken it when it was here. You've taken it to the tune of $5 billion.
When was that first developed, the spillover?
1974.
And so in the last 36 years, how much have you received?
How much or
from
how many
spillover.
Years? How much or how many years?
From spillover. In 36.
Many, many years there was zero because of the economic conditions in the world. That's right. So the historic sources were in place. When there was spillover, more often than not, it was taken. And under the current economic conditions, which I'm not aware of any economist projecting, you know, a drastic change over the next 10 to 20 to 30 years, seems like you're going to have the rest of the sales tax base where it's at with the high gas prices, which produces spillover.
Is this $450 million the most you've received in any one year?
The $450 million, Senator Lowenthal, split by the gas tax swap produces a state transit. You know what? The answer is no. In 06-07, the State Transit Assistance Program produced $613 million. And Kerry's telling you that was because of a repayment of Prop 42, which beefed that up, right? So the average program for the last 5 years, where you've got more accurate, you know, revenue and expense income figures, the average SDA program was about $200 million. There also was a like amount on the capital side. The swap absolutely shifted Morgan into SDA. But that has created today, as we speak, the CTC had to adopt an allocation program for transit capital projects. There are $258 million of transit capital projects that are supposed to be funded in 10-11. Those are jobs, and those are people getting to work when those things are funded. Because of the swap, where you held the gun to our head and said, how do you want it? We'll take the formula program if we have to. Now there's no money for the capital projects. Today, the CTC had to adopt an allocation plan that says we don't have enough money. There just isn't enough transit money. Is $450 million more than we've ever received? No. It's less. On average, the state transit assistance program would be projected to be higher under the swap. It still would be projected to be higher under Prop 22. And here's the real answer to the question, why are we dying to get less money? We're not. You know that. We're dying to get money. Protected money, constitutional protection. My mother didn't raise me to run initiatives. I chose to become a lobbyist. I've had a long, productive relationship with many of you. The two chairs have been strong proponents for public transit. We appreciate that. The budget chair has worked very hard to try to find resources. The fact is, even through this year, you've still taken money from transit, $1 billion this year. How many times can I say that? I appreciate you all voted to improve transit this year. You're all, unfortunately, going to be gone at some point. I'm going to be gone. What's going to be left is the California State Constitution. The voters are either going to agree with me that the remaining funds, the one revenue source that is left after you destroyed three of them, is either going to be protected or it's not. Either protected at a lower level, or they're going to vote no, and it's going to be higher potentially this year, but vulnerable. Who knows what the future legislature or future governors are going to do?
Do you think it's a good idea to put the general obligation bonds, the debt service, back into the general fund?
All I know, Senator Lowenthal, is that for...
Do you think that's a good idea?
I don't. I think for decades, we ran a program where you sold to the voters general obligation bonds. And by the way, our reading of that you can still pay bond debt service under the gas tax swap and under Prop 22 for bonds already sold to the voters, every one of those bonds was sold as a general obligation bond. And we're still saying we're going to allow you to use our transportation funds to pay the bond debt service, although I don't think that's a great idea. I understand the restrictions under which you're working, and I respect your difficult decisions on the general fund.
You don't think like the LAO does that we need a second vote to be able to do that after Prop 22 passes, if it passed?
I get why they think that's possible. We don't read it that way, and I'll commit to you to work to you know, ensure that that doesn't have to happen for the bonds that have already been sold. We want to respect, after you've done what you've done to destroy the $1 billion of transit funding and beefed up what's left, I will keep saying that.
It's a really unfair characterization if it very few years that it was even close to $1 billion.
Let's talk about the potential. That's fair. Let's talk about the potential. The big $1 billion came up in 07-08, the year we sued. Before our lawsuit went to the California State Supreme Court, before it went to the Third District Court of Appeal, we called the governor's office because his officials were, you know, the defendants in our suit, and said, there's got to be a way to work this out where there's a fair share for public transit that I think gets to the vision that you all have of a 21st century transit system while respecting your needs on the general fund. And we said, let's figure out how to do a statutory conformance to what we actually think is the law under Prop 116 that we had nothing to do with. That option, which your leadership staff and many of your committee staff knew about, so legislature could have entertained that question also, we heard crickets, so it went all the way to the Supreme Court, and we won, but we lost.
Did you propose a bill?
Didn't we ultimately lose?
Did you sponsor a bill?
We asked people, yeah. No, because no one would introduce that. Sponsor, shop around, yeah, absolutely.
Any other questions? Let's hear from the, we've heard from the proponents. Let's go on.
We ended up getting tirade by transit, but we never got back to the property tax piece.
I'm in a tirade mood. Sorry.
Sure, Senator, you'd like me to address the property tax
piece? The property tax piece. I mean, that, why is this not just adding more to my eternal puzzle of just complicating our lives with all the things that you rightfully point out have made things, everybody since Prop 13 has tried to find a way around Prop 13. And every time they do it, they add a layer of complication. And I don't understand why this, you said at the beginning you thought this undid this, but you didn't repeal 1A, you didn't repeal 42, you didn't repeal the 1986 saying that BLF should have gone to the cities, which of course now we've undone with the other part of Prop 1A or the different
right,
Prop
right.
1A, whatever. I mean, you didn't solve any of those problems.
For all the studies, and you've
and
been...
I think you just added to it.
You've been here for many of the studies that call for comprehensive, multifaceted reform. The reality is the legislature hasn't gotten a bill out to do it. There hasn't been an initiative measure to do a comprehensive reform measure. We have started down the road, I believe, and I think we're in the midst of other major reforms right now. Sometimes we don't know when we're in the middle of them. But in this area, the state-local area, it started with Prop 1A. It then happened, it was affected again in 2006 with the second Prop 1A dealing with Prop 42. And this is going to be the third step in that direction. Here's how it simplifies. Well, this one actually is going to simplify it by eliminating the borrowing provision, which ensures that the money is used for city, county, and special district revenues. It retains the ability of the legislature to deal with the problems that arise in the property tax system by changing shares if necessary, but not for the purpose of funding the state general fund. Because we know when you shift property tax monies to schools, it's to offset the burden on the state general fund.
So can we repeal the 1A that gave you the property tax for the VLF and get back to square?
Actually, I don't think the property tax VLF swap was a function of 1A. That was a statutory deal that was
at the same
time.
No, it wasn't. It was voter approved.
Pardon me?
It was voter approved. In 2004,
there is protection
at your insistence
revenues
in order to give you the property tax when the governor
that was actually
vetoed the VLF.
Senator, I respect your intelligence and your knowledge here. My recollection is somewhat different that was a parallel statutory measure. It was not ever part of a deal that we asked for.
So does that mean we can repeal it?
And give us
if
VLF
it's a statutory
in exchange?
Well, there isn't any, so you get what the governor did, which was no VLF. You were protected under the 1986 initiative from the VLF going directly to cities and counties.
Correct.
When the governor repealed the VLF, he essentially took that money from the cities and counties. The response of the legislature and the governor was to say, we will swap property tax for your lost revenues. That has cost the state, not the state. I hate this saying we've taken money to the general fund. Nobody's taken any money to the general fund. Property tax goes to schools. If it doesn't go to cities and counties and special districts, it goes to schools. So money was shifted from schools, which for the last 5 years has cost us $6 billion a year, shifted from schools to cities and counties. Now, if you're saying that was statutory,
Senator,
I
may be totally incorrect. Well, but the revenue it produces is protected by 1A. If you decide to change it, it is protected by 1A. I think the VLF property tax shift from a policy perspective in terms of reducing the incentives for retail development, it accomplished that objective. And that was one of the reasons for the proposal. I was there when the governor came up with the idea, and Mike Genest was finance director, or he was deputy at the time. I remember talking to him. That, I believe, was the major reason for the proposal. It wasn't our idea.
Well, you wanted to be backfilled for the loss of revenue that the governor had essentially taken from you.
That is correct, because it pays for basic police and fire and other local services. That's right.
Right. So you got property tax, which then over the next 3 years increased substantially while there was no revenue coming from the VLF.
And that has cost the schools $6 billion a year.
Now it's four.
Right. It's dropped considerably.
So are you okay then with taking back the subventions from the VLF that was put up last year? You said you don't want VLF spent
taking
on state.
Taking back the subventions from the ones they use for the cops.
The 0.15.
Are we okay with
since,
that?
Well, no, since you're got, saying got, here you don't want us to use VLF
we've got a record.
For local
well, actually,
costs.
Well, actually, that is, Senator, as you'll recall, that was an additional VLF amount. And we supported it at the time, and we supported its extension to be used for those targeted purposes. Now, the remaining little bit of VLF, it's roughly about $200 million. That's about all that's left. And that amount does go to cities, and it's been used in part to help some of the newer cities develop. There's some boosts, as you'll recall, for that.
So now you have both the VLF and the property tax, and now you want all the fuel tax.
There's hardly any VLF left.
Well, there's
a small
the counties
amount.
Get some.
Yes, as part of their realignment package, they get that. That was part of the early 90s realignment deal.
But if we kept the 1%, 1.15 in place.
It was the 0.15, was it? I'm sorry.
The 0.15 is the part that
is the part that you
dedicated
you added,
to the
yes.
subventions. Well, we added, no, well, we added the part between 0.65.
Correct.
So
right.
there's another 0.45 that right. we're getting today.
Right. And your question is, do we support that or not? We do support it, Senator.
But you want to keep the subventions, even though you want to take $1 billion out of the general fund. You want to keep the $450 million that we could otherwise keep.
Well, I think the state has had a policy, the legislature has had a policy of supporting those law enforcement programs. We have
supported
them as well.
You don't think getting this extra billion back, I mean, costing us $1 billion? Makes that
well,
hard to do?
As Josh said, and I think the commitment goes from us too, you know, we didn't envision the swap and the shift dealing with the bonds. Listen, the closest we ever got to suing the state of California was last summer when you almost took the $1 billion of city and county share of the HUDA. And I didn't want to do it then, and my board didn't want to do it then. We have no desire to make your lives more complicated in dealing with the bonds. So we'll work with you on that. That is our goal, is to make sure that these revenues go to transportation. And that's what we've been trying to accomplish with this measure, as well as local government.
How many, you want, your thing is no more loans to schools from redevelopment either, right?
Of course, it's not a loan, Senator. It's an outright diversion of the money.
Those have been shifts.
Yeah, the 2.1, which, by the way, is the equivalent of 198,000 full and part-time, largely construction jobs, people who would have been paying important revenue to the state of California. We know
teachers pay revenue, too.
Of course they pay revenue. The construction industry generates a very important part of the revenue component for the state. You know this better than I do, how important those jobs are.
But redevelopment agree, doesn't always important. Do that. I mean, I'm not.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, folks.
And Toby Boyd, board member of the California Teachers Association. Welcome.
Well, Chairman.
You can decide among yourselves how you want to divide your time.
Thank you. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen of the committee. My name is Toby Boyd, and I'm an elementary school teacher in Elk Grove Unified School District. I'm here today representing 325,000 teachers and other educators in the California Teachers Association. We are strongly opposed to Proposition 22. Simply put, California schools cannot afford it, Proposition 22. The so-called protections in the initiative would prioritize things like developer subsidies, over adequate funding for our schools. Given that $17 billion in funding has already been cut from public schools' budget in the past 2 years, the goal of Proposition 22 are well out of step with the direction California should be headed in. In Elk Grove, in my school district itself, in grades kindergarten through six, we've seen class sizes increase, and we've also seen only one nurse for every 5,000 children in our school. We've also seen all of our librarians be laid off, and just recently we've seen them come back because of federal funding. Nearby Natomas and Folsom Cordova school districts have cut their counseling staff by 50%, and many school districts have cut 5 days from their students. These types of cuts have both immediate and long-term effects on our students. If Proposition 22 passes, the situation will get even worse. I want to take a moment to tell the committee just how Proposition 22 would impact our schools. First, if Proposition 22 passes, it would immediately cut nearly $1 billion from our schools. A provision in Proposition 22 retroactively changes the law, disallowing a protection the state legislator put in place to balance our state budget last year. This change would immediately blow an over $2 billion hole in the budget. That means just as schools getting started underway, we have larger classes, fewer educators, programs, and supplies, we will face even bigger cuts. California cannot continue to pull back from its commitment to its most important investment, educating our children. To make matters worse, Proposition 22 wouldn't just cut our education budget once. It would do so every year afterwards in the tune of about $400 million. This is simply outrageous. A provision of 22 would route $1 billion of sales tax money from gas sales out of the state general fund every year. The fact is that regardless of what money is earmarked for, when money moves from the general fund and impacts this Proposition 98, I'm a little nervous, minimizing funding guarantees. If Proposition 22 passes, $1 billion sales tax goes to its own special fund, and the Proposition 98 guarantee goes down. While the calculation is complex, the outcome is straightforward. Schools will get shortchanged, and our students will lose out. I think the Sacramento Bee summed it up nicely in the September 18th editorial that asked voters to vote no on Proposition 22, and I quote, "Proposition 22 is ill-timed and is an overreach and should be rejected," unquote. Now I will give you a little history to make an important point. In 2004, 84% of the voters passed Proposition 1A, a measure similar to Proposition 22. But there was a vitally important difference. The people who wrote Proposition 1A knew that when a fiscal crisis hit the state, policymakers need every tool in their toolbox to balance the budget. Right now, the only way the state can borrow local funds is if the governor declares a fiscal emergency and two-thirds of the state legislature votes to approve the shift. That's a high bar. Also, the state must pay back the borrowed money with interest in 3 years, and the state cannot borrow from local governments more than twice in a 10-year period. I think the LAO referenced that. Now here's the most important part. Because Proposition 22 is a constitutional amendment, if it passes, it cannot under any circumstances be overridden, even in the case of a dire fiscal emergency such as what occurred in 2008 and 2009. Ironically, Proposition 98, our minimum school funding guarantee, can and has been overridden. So not only would Proposition 22 cut billions from our school's budget, it would increase the likelihood that the state would be faced with further cash flow problems and more state budget cuts. This is unfair. Unfair to our students who deserve a good education. Unfair to California. We urge you to vote no on Proposition 22, and I thank you.
Next.
Mr. and Madam Chairman, Brian Hatch on behalf of the California Professional Firefighters. Prior to coming to Sacramento to lobby the legislature, I served as 10 years in the Ontario Fire Department as a captain in charge of an engine company, putting out fires and trying to save people in auto accidents and the like. The proponents of Prop 22 claim that this measure would protect local revenue from the state. But I believe nothing could be further from the truth. The California Redevelopment Act is actually a state program with no designated oversight agency, which delegates to cities and counties the power to strip precious property tax revenues from every other local government agency that levies a property tax, including school districts, community college districts, fire districts, and a multitude of other special purpose districts, as well as from their own city and county general funds. While local governments are struggling to make ends meet, the redevelopment agencies are growing and prospering. Analysis of reports published by the State Comptroller's Office show that property tax funds shifted under state law from local governments to redevelopment agencies are about $7.4 billion a year, and it's growing at about 17% a year. The property tax increment, as they call it, received by redevelopment agencies is more than triple the amount of property tax leftovers apportioned to the sponsoring cities and counties, which are striving to fund vital public services. These redevelopment agencies are flourishing while the vital public services are withering. In round numbers extracted from reports published by the State Comptroller's Office, show that redevelopment agencies spend more than $300 million a year on investment bankers, lawyers, accountants, and various other consultants. Redevelopment agencies spend 22 times more money on administrative costs than on relocation payments to dispossessed residents who were forced from their homes by redevelopment projects. Redevelopment agencies spend nearly $10 billion a year, have run up nearly $100 billion in public debt without a vote of the people, and are sitting on nearly $20 billion in what I would call surplus cash. The redevelopment agencies sponsoring cities and counties have loaned and gifted huge sums of taxpayer funds to their redevelopment agencies. Although the gifts and grants are not as well documented, however, redevelopment agencies currently owe, according to the state controller, $18 billion to their sponsoring cities and counties. At a time when all local governments are struggling for economic survival, the redevelopment agencies haven't offered to repay one penny of debt to their sponsoring cities and counties. The classic example of the city of San Diego, which, like many other cities, is struggling with a staggeringly outsized structural deficit. The city is so desperate that it's resorted to closing nearly a quarter of its fire stations each day. While the city is frantically plays Russian roulette with public safety, the San Diego County Redevelopment Agency, which owes the city nearly $300 million, has, instead of offering any debt repayment, demanded that the redevelopment agency debt be forgiven. In Northern California, the foundering city of Vallejo might well have been able to avoid bankruptcy if only it had received repayment of even half of the funds that the city had loaned to its redevelopment agency. Special districts have very limited choices to replace property tax revenues taken from them. This is especially true of fire districts. Fire districts provide fire protection and emergency medical services to nearly half of the state's residents. Fire districts also provide fire protection and emergency medical services to the residents of more than 100 cities, as well as nearly all of the unincorporated territories of the 58 counties, most of which sponsor redevelopment agencies. Over the life of the Community Redevelopment Act, fire districts have been forced to surrender billions of dollars in property tax revenue to redevelopment agency project areas where they are obliged to serve and provide fire protection. Efforts by fire districts to strike tax increment pass-through agreements with redevelopment agencies have been met with limited success, as the fire districts have no leverage over the redevelopment agencies. The impact of redevelopment agencies on fire districts has been crippling. Demand for fire protection and emergency medical services has ballooned in redevelopment agency project areas. All the while, the redevelopment agencies of those sponsoring cities and counties have devoured ever-increasing portions of the property tax revenues of those very same fire districts. In response to the onslaught of redevelopment activities, many of these fire districts have been forced to reduce their firefighting forces and delay the purchase of replacement fire apparatus and equipment. The most outrageous examples of this phenomenon lie within Los Angeles County, where redevelopment agencies composed of entire cities, redevelopment agencies that use eminent domain to demolish existing homes, to build high-rise luxury condos and big-box retail complexes, auto malls, and sports stadiums. Redevelopment agencies that increasingly overburden the resources of the Los Angeles County Fire Department, which is a fire district, while confiscating the property tax revenues of that very fire district. Listening to some of the comments that were made earlier, I just have to say that ever there was a state program that is in need of reform, it is the California Redevelopment Act. Proposition 22 will prevent any future reform of local redevelopment practices, no matter how horrifying they may be. For that reason alone, Prop 22 should be rejected by the voters. The League of California Cities should hang their heads in shame for sponsoring Prop 22, a measure that fosters, encourages, and protects such greed and avarice and self-serving behavior. Their assertion that redevelopment funds are dedicated to police and fire protection is laughable at best. At worst, it is a blatant effort to deceive the voters. It's up to the rest of us to speak up and see Prop 22 does not pass.
Thank you. Next, Captain Dennis. Kathy Dennis, board member of the California Nurses Association. Welcome.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Mr. and Madam Chairs and members. My name, as you've stated already, is Kathy Dennis, and I'm a registered nurse at Mercy General Hospital here in Sacramento. I've been a nurse for 12 years, and I am a board member of the California Nurses Association. Today, I'm here representing those 86,000 members of CNA and to tell you why we oppose Proposition 22. Our friends, the teachers and the firefighters, have stated many of the reasons why teachers, firefighters, and nurses should oppose this flawed initiative. But I wanted to specifically touch on the health care implications caused by Proposition 22. Prop 22 will leave us all in danger, a greater danger from fires and other natural disasters due to the lack of the funds for these services that serve our community. It means cuts in emergency medical services, forcing longer response times in all major emergencies. Nurses and other healthcare professionals know that the sooner a patient gets to the hospital, the higher the likelihood of a good patient outcome. Simply put, delays in getting to the hospital, longer wait times in our EDs will result in bad patient outcomes and increased patients' deaths. Our firefighters are really responsible for a lot of these paramedics' emergency services and bring those patients to our hospitals. Additionally, Proposition 22 will reduce funding available for health care at a time when our safety net is already collapsing. CNA represents nurses at many clinics and county hospitals, and nurses know that the decline in the economy has impacted these facilities. The most disadvantaged members of our communities use these very services that most likely face deeper cuts if Prop 22 passes. If Prop 22 passes, vital services that California's most vulnerable populations rely on will be cut. The poor, blind, disabled, and senior citizens are already suffering enough in this era of austere budgets. Safety net programs and social services have faced years of cutting due to bad budgets, and there is nothing left to cut without the destruction of these programs. Aside from the direct impact to education and fire services, it is important to note that in-home support services that allow our senior citizens and the disabled to live with dignity in their own homes will be targeted with future cuts if Prop 22 passes. Prop 22 will create cuts in funding for health care, and it will place additional strain on county hospitals that serve the poor and uninsured. And Prop 22 locks in protections for redevelopment agencies in California's Constitution. It will use local property taxes to fund subsidies for local developers with no direct voter oversight. Funds that would have otherwise been available for schools, fire protections, children's health care, parks, and libraries. Supporters of Prop 22 will claim that this somehow helps public services. Nurses disagree. Our tax dollars should go first to schools, public safety, and health care. They should go last to the developers and the redevelopment agencies that support this proposal. Thank you.
Thank you. Senator Cheney?
I think that this point about, I hadn't really thought of it in those terms. So it locks in current redevelopment law in a way, Mr. Hatch? And maybe we can ask Mr. McKenzie come up and answer some of those questions too. Because what I was thinking as I listened to this was if magically redevelopment agencies disappeared tomorrow, wouldn't the cities get their fair share? I mean, I'm looking back at the LAO's chart on the distribution of property tax. And actually, I was sort of surprised at the number here. The pie chart makes it look like redevelopment agencies pretty much are getting almost as much as cities at this point, which at one point it would have been much narrower.
Right. It's been continuing to take
to
an
grow.
Increasing share as each year goes by.
And would this lock us into not being able to even stop new redevelopment agencies or extensions? I mean, a lot of redevelopment agencies are, the one you described, San Diego, the downtown San Diego one, is reaching its 30-year lifespan fairly soon, I think, because Pete Wilson was mayor when we did it. So
under operation of current law, they can extend that life of that agency by raising its cap. The City Council authorized a study to go forward recently.
Can they do that on their own without further?
Yes.
So then the only answer to that would be sort of if we repealed redevelopment statute and stopped allowing new ones or extensions. I mean, what would happen to the property tax?
My belief is that if Prop 22 passes, the legislature will be powerless to amend or repeal the Redevelopment Act.
Could we ask
Mr. McKenzie
the LAO
and the LAO
address this issue, because this was really not...
We didn't explore it earlier, and I'm sort of...
Impact does Prop 22 have on redevelopment law?
Okay. Our reading of Proposition 22 is it would prohibit the legislature from redirecting any redevelopment property taxes to schools or another entity. It would also limit the legislature's authority to change pass-through payments from redevelopment agencies to other local agencies. It would not prohibit the legislature, say, in the future, to say there shall be no redefining, for example, the definition of blight or changing the threshold for creation of a new redevelopment project or the extension of a redevelopment project. We don't read Proposition 22 as extending to those issues.
Yeah, we should. Okay. You don't see that. Mr. Hatch,
there's a provision in the measure that says that the cities have the right to operate under the redevelopment law as it existed on a certain date. I don't remember it exactly, but it's a date that's already passed.
Oh, so that would imply that we can't change that law.
That could be a two-edged sword, though, couldn't it? If they're scheduled to end in 30 years and it couldn't be adjusted, then they would have to end and all of them, I don't know a single one that isn't fighting for an extension.
Right. But they can, under current law, they can extend by themselves with no, and that would be the law they'd be locking in. That's the problem.
No, right? I don't think they can extend by themselves.
If they wish to extend under existing law, they have to make a finding of continuing blight.
Right.
And there are certain
procedures.
And we continue to have blight in Coronado and Palm Desert.
I do not think that the measure extends to
San Francisco.
Wait, let's just hear.
I do not think that the measure extends to the legislature's authority to, say, redefine blight or change the terms of prospective redevelopment projects or for extensions.
But what if we just said, I mean, the way he read that, I mean, it makes it exist under that law as effective whatever date. Mm-hmm. Question is, could we say there shall be no more? That's it. Whatever's there is there. It's done. It's over. And from here on out, property tax will be divided as it should be under Prop 13 or however.
And existing projects will live until they have fully
until they're done. Yeah.
Let's let the league respond
to that. I don't think it limits the legislature's authority to say
prospectively. Prospectively, it does not limit the legislature.
The legislature's authority to say, for example, there's a moratorium on all new redevelopment projects. I don't believe it affects that.
Do you agree?
We agree entirely.
You agree with the legislature?
Yeah, there's a slight restriction in the legislature's power to change the pass-through requirements. It totally protects the affordable housing requirements that you've put in place. We believe it retains everything else that is your authority under the Redevelopment Act, which Article 16 gave you and which is unaffected by this. The only purpose of this provision, and I think Brian's just reading it very, very broadly, is to make it clear that redevelopment revenues are to be used for redevelopment and not for other purposes.
Mm-hmm. Other purposes meaning schools inside redevelopment areas don't count.
Schools or whatever else the legislature may decide.
Well, not the legislature, the cities and schools. I mean, he's right. Cities are taking that money and refusing to use it to support their own general fund, and then you're saying, well, and we need this fuel tax money back to do that.
Cities are also using redevelopment funds to construct fire stations, and so are other county redevelopment agencies. This has been done extensively.
But they're not using it for operations. They're starving to death. They're overpaying city managers like crazy. The hearing in the upstairs floor is dealing with. They're paying people salaries and such, and they're closing fire stations, and they're closing libraries, and they're laying people off, and then they're saying, but we can build the building, we just can't
put firefighters.
Continue to have services. We're going to close the libraries, we're going to lay off the firefighters. San Diego's got blackouts going on right now with firefighters.
Mm-hmm. And
they're laying off cops.
And cuts to Parks and Recreation, 25%.
And you're saying the reason for Prop 22 is to give you more resources to do operations, but you don't use cities, in fact, wall off the redevelopment property tax that without a redevelopment area, they might have that property tax in their general fund, and cities would, in fact, be able to provide the services that they're supposed to provide with the property tax dollars back to our... I'm with you on the, I want everybody to have their piece and know what it's for and who gets it and what it's spent for. And if you undid redevelopment in some ways, you would have... several billion dollars a year in the general fund of the city.
That's true, and we would not be putting money, the same money, into investing in building infrastructure, which is going to spark new economic development, which will create new jobs. I mean, this is the perpetual debate we have.
Right.
And we're not trying to stop that, but this is money. In 1952, when the voters approved a proposition that the legislature put on, to say this money should be used to redevelop blighted areas. And you mm-hmm. retain full authority to just affect massive parts of the actions of redevelopment agencies. Prop 22 doesn't affect that. But the money is supposed to be used for those purposes in the Constitution, not for operating expenses.
And how many decades does it take to redevelop a city?
Well, that's the problem. I mean, it has become... I mean, I was here when, well...
Well, we're not here to really discuss some of these tangential...
Right, that's your prerogative.
That's our prerogative. What you're saying is Prop 22 does not impact the legislature's ability to set criteria and definitions.
Correct.
That's
correct.
All you're saying. Right. That's fine.
But it could be interpreted that way, and I'm not sure. Is anybody here from the redevelopment agencies? Yes. You might not sue on
John
that, but they might.
John Shire.
Just before you leave there's another provision.
On Brian's point.
On page 19 of this appendix, which is the text of the law itself, and the league's amendments would say that the legislature shall not change the pro rata share of ad valorem property taxes pursuant to this paragraph. You can't end redevelopment agencies and keep faith with that provision.
Which article?
That provision doesn't apply to redevelopment because they don't receive a proportionate share of the ad valorem property tax. Instead,
yes, they do.
Effectively, they do. Effectively,
yes, they do.
They do. But that provision of the Constitution...
And you've got a lot at stake here to be saying, I don't think.
That provision of the Constitution doesn't apply to redevelopment agencies.
Right.
They get a share of the tax increment, which is a calculation after the original ad valorem tax is allocated.
Yeah, I want to.
Interesting problem.
All right. I don't want to make this a major issue about redevelopment. So, John.
Senator, this is John Shire, I'm the Executive Director of California Redevelopment Association. I just want to say for the third time, I agree with everything Marianne told you. She's absolutely right.
Good.
About the interpretation of Prop 22 and what Mr. McKenzie told you. Doesn't do anything to change your ability to change the law governing redevelopment agencies in California, and you do it pretty regularly.
Right. Yeah, that's not my problem with the initiative. Thank you.
Well, I am very concerned about the property tax going to cities to use for those things and not being used for services. And the nurse's point about us not having it. Now, you're saying we could still shift the monies between counties, cities, and special districts. So if, in fact, this passed, could we shift money back to the counties to support health and human services?
No.
This measure does not affect the legislature's authority to reallocate property taxes between cities, counties, and special districts.
So, in theory,
that is authority you have with the two-thirds
vote. We could then shift money back to the counties. Back to the counties to support health and human services when the general fund gets hit by the $1 billion.
You can reallocate property taxes. Under Proposition 13, the responsibility for allocating the 1% property tax was handed to the state legislature. You pass the laws that direct the county auditor how to divide up the property tax. Proposition 1A put a restriction on your authority, but they still gave you full authority to reallocate amongst counties, cities, and special districts upon a two-thirds vote.
Yeah, it's the two-thirds vote. As we see, that's a very easy hurdle to overcome in doing budget, so we have no problem with that.
Again, on page 20 of the text of the proposed law, section 7 that's added by this measure, directly relating to redevelopment agency, refers to that funding as ad valorem property tax revenues. It does not talk about tax increment.
Yeah.
I'd be happy to chat with anyone regarding this particular provision, but that was not our understanding of the measure,
Thank you.
Affected your authority to transfer property taxes or to alter the pass-through payments, but it did not affect your broad legislative authority over the continuation of redevelopment or the establishment of redevelopment.
Thank you. Thank you. Are there members of the public that wish to come up and address? Not seeing any. I wonder, I have a question that I'd like to, I kind of raised it early on. I'd like to ask maybe Chris McKenzie to come back. And that was the question that was raised in the analysis. I think you've seen the analysis, and that was the question that came up.
The LEO analysis was the chair of the staff.
The background paper by the staff, and that was on page 8, and I'll read that on the proposed initiative, the second one. For transportation bond repayment purposes, why does Proposition 22 treat local governments' use of gas tax revenues differently than the state's use of these revenues, i.e., why does it require a vote of the people and permit prospective use only for the state? What was the motivation? Why do you have a different set for local government as versus the state on these?
Senator, as we indicated, local governments have to get a vote of the people as well before they can issue bonds that can be paid off with proceeds of the HUDA, just like the state. And that is how it's used. There's been some...
But they can use for perspective. It has to have a vote of the people for a two-thirds vote?
It has to have a vote of the people. And as I said earlier, we disagree. We don't think you're going to have to get a second vote in order to use bonds. And nor would we be insisting that in any way.
All right. So you disagree with the LAO's interpretation on that, that there really is a second hurdle... was the question.
The senator talked about the prospective retroactive issue, but we think even beyond that, that you have a lot more flexibility to do that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other?
So then what's protected? If we can still do that, what do you get out of this?
Well, Senator, the transportation revenues are restricted to transportation.
But they are now. It's just that we get to use them for transportation bond debt.
Well,
so that's current law.
I'd be happy to visit with you about some of the other provisions in it, but we've added provisions that we believe provide substantial protections to local governments. For example, the attempted use of the money last year without borrowing would be even more explicitly prohibited than it is under the current Constitution.
The HUDA you're talking about.
The HUDA, yes.
But on the provision that is the most troubling, you get no benefit under your theory. That we could still use, if we can still use the transportation money under the gas tax.
25% of your share of the HUDA.
No, of the gas tax. Assuming the gas tax swap is not repealed, as you indicate,
yes.
You don't believe you are, even though everybody else in the world believes you are.
No.
If that were true, then we would be able to continue to pay transportation bond debt with those funds. And then there is no difference in how those funds are used today.
Senator, I can just assure you that in the drafting of this measure, and of course we couldn't be prescient, we tried to anticipate possibilities. Put in that future revenues or that replacement revenues concept with an understanding that the legislature might choose to have a different kind of transportation revenue.
Mm-hmm.
And we just wanted to make sure that the same basic kinds of protections flowed through to the appropriate shares, subject to future change by the legislature. We've accepted there's some gamble here, but we put in a provision that the CTC has to hold public hearings. They have to do a study. It has to be related to the transportation needs of the state. These are none of the things that are in current law that have to be done.
But that's even just to spend money on debt? I mean, we'd have to do that?
Well, I think we'd have to look at the existing allocations, how they are now after the tax swap, to see if that's the case. But if you're going to change the shares in the future, that will be the rules of the game.
Change shares
among the state and local governments.
Well, you get your 6 cents under this deal. But everything else you're saying we could use for transportation bond debt and other things?
Senator, under current law and in the future, you could decide that all the HUDA, I'm going to call it all HUDA, can go to local governments. Or you could decide it could all go to the state. That's been the law since 1922 when the gas tax was created. You get to decide what the shares are. There has historically been a local share because we don't levy an excise tax on gasoline for obvious reasons.
Right.
But this body retains the ability to change those shares.
But not under this. Not if this passes.
Under 22, you do as well.
I thought you said before you're making it constitutional.
No, this has been. It's been.
Everybody else up here has said.
It's been overstated, Senator, and I think the LAO will agree.
But it's by a two-thirds vote.
It is by a two-thirds vote.
Well,
yes.
That's you.
That is right.
You conveniently do not.
Well, that is what we wrote in a similar provision as in Prop 42.
And that's what we're really looking for: more two-thirds votes, because it's really helped us so much.
Well, there's that. Yeah. I don't know that anybody else, your own legal theory of this is contradictory to every other legal theory of everybody else in the state, so it makes it a little bit difficult to swallow. But,
well, I understand,
and I think
why
the confusion, I'm back to my original problem with the confusion you create with this initiative is just more of the negative thing that you talked about at the beginning that everybody wants to undo. And I feel like you're just piling another piece onto that famous chart that Marianne has that just, you know, adds to the inflexibility in an environment where we already are overly inflexible, where redevelopment was essentially became used to undercut Prop 98, and now you're doing other things to undercut this one, and every one of them piles on, and Prop 98 was a reaction to Prop 13, and everybody's piling up, and nobody's undoing anything and making the lines, in fact, clearer about what is the money that gets used and who gets to spend it. And obviously the hearing upstairs is talking about local government and some of the issues that have come up in cities where you know, folks in Bell didn't even know that, you know, what their city council was spending. Those kinds of things are, you know, is comes from this. And nobody knows where the money comes from, and then nobody's accountable for spending it.
And I
think this is just going to make that worse and not better.
And I think that's the big problem.
We just respectfully disagree.
Can I ask you, getting back to section of the initiative itself that I have, because I still see it differently, that there is different requirements to the cities than there is to the state. Under section 6...
That's 6.5 of Article 19.
Yeah, Article 19 this is? Yeah. That's section 6 of the
6.5
article.
Now.
6.5. It says up to 25% of the revenues allocated to the state pursuant to section 4... for the purposes specified in subdivision A, which is the gas tax, of section 2 of this article, may be pledged or used by the state, here it is, upon approval by the voters and appropriation by the legislature. So that's a vote of the legislature. That's a vote of the people for the payment of principal and interest on voter-approved bonds. So you've had to first have a voter-approved bond, and then you have to go back to the vote of the people.
Mm-hmm.
If you look at Section B, it says up to 25% of the revenues allocated to any city or county pursuant to Section 4 for the purposes specified in Subdivision A of Section 2 of this article may be pledged or used only by any city or county for the payment of principal and interest on voter-approved bonds issued by that city or county. It doesn't ask them to do a second. There is a second vote for the state, a single vote for the...
Well, Senator, it's a construction that our attorneys have told us they don't agree with. This idea of a second vote, that you'd have to go back, have second approval for bonds that have already been approved by the people but have not yet been issued, is, we think, a very, very strange construction.
We do, too. So it just seems like there are differences. Now, you're saying
there are,
your interpretation is that there's only one required voter approval.
Absolutely.
Okay, which would make sense, but it doesn't seem to us in
I've never heard of going to the voters for
I've never either,
approval.
But I didn't write the legislation, the initiative, so.
Right. Of course you didn't. Thank you.
You know, I found this, I'm going to, in closing and then ask, I found this hearing more than just interesting, quite lively, and not a typical hearing. But what I did hear today is that my real concern is that if Proposition 22 does pass, it will only worsen the relationship between local governments and the state that began to deteriorate and to disintegrate after the passage of Proposition 13. I believe it will divide us even more. We all have the same common interest to serve the people of this state, and rather than having us work together, this will be another example of us working at different differences, working apart. I do not think that this brings us together to solve problems, but really does to divide us. I can understand the initial motivation. I understand some of the issues that go. I think that this answer will divide us more than it will find solutions. But that said, that's just my opinion. The voters of California will decide this issue on November 2nd. And so I'd like to thank all the witnesses of this lively discussion. As always, the legislature relies heavily upon the expert analysis of budget and initiative proposals that the legislative analyst and his office provides. I want to thank Marianne O'Malley and Jessica DiGiambattista for today's insights. I also want to thank the initiative sponsors, Josh Shaw from the California Transit Association and Chris McKenzie with the League of California Cities for presenting Prop 22 to the committee, and to the opponents, Brian Hatch with the firefighters, Kathy Dennis with the Nurses Association, and Toby Boyd with the California Teachers Association. I appreciate, and I share with you that other committee members appreciate your taking the time to participate in this hearing and telling us what you see and why you oppose this and the impact of Prop 22. But with that, unless there's any other comment, I'd like to call this hearing to a close. Thank you all for attending. This hearing is closed.